My guest today is a successful songwriter, producer, and keyboardist who's back with his prog band Frost. They're back with a brand new album, their first studio album since 2008, called Falling Satellites. It comes out May 27th. I'd like to welcome Jem Godfrey.
Hey, man. How you doing?
Good. How are you, man?
I'm good. God, you're very clear. Crystal clear.
Yeah, you too. The wonders of the internet.
I know. It wasn't like this 8 years ago.
So are you based out of London, or where are you now exactly?
No, I'm kind of about, it's not far. In sort of US terms, it's like the same neighborhood. I'm about 80 miles south of London.
Okay, cool. Was doing a prog thing always something you wanted to do first, and the pop and you know, and producing and all the other things you do sort of got in the way, or backwards, or how did you get involved?
It was kind of my first band when I was at high school was a prog band, and we were awful. And so I kind of, you know, basically sort of as you get sort of older, I got to about 17, 18, and I realized that we weren't going to get anywhere. So I had to sort of put that to one side and get a job in a radio station. And so kind of the prog things just went by. I didn't think about it anymore because I was just trying to busy get a career going, you know, and working really hard and trying to build something up. And then the pop thing happened as a direct result of working in a radio station, because you get to meet pluggers and all kinds of things, and, you know, one thing followed the other, and then we had a really, really good 5 years doing sort of pop. But then at the end of that, kind of, if you do that all the time, I was just saying to Tommy earlier, if all you do is, if you just have the same dinner every night, it drives you mad. And so basically, by the time I'd got to sort of year four or five of doing pop, I was just hating it, you know, because it was so sort of formulaic, and you couldn't really express yourself musically too much because it was in a very sort of squeaky clean era with pop in the sort of early 2000s.
Yeah.
And so it evolved as a response, a pressure valve against doing sort of pop stuff. But because obviously I'd been doing it at quite a high level at that point, my production chops were kind of quite good. And so I just thought, wouldn't it be nice to apply pop production to like really subversive progressive rock? And so I hadn't been following prog at all. And so I sort of came back to it and was just doing some research. And I was staggered. I was amazed that there was so much going on, you know, with Spox and all these amazing bands that were I hadn't heard of that had sort of cropped up in the time I'd been away. And you know, and bands like IQ were still going and Pendragon and, you know, and it was just a really, I remember thinking, this is a scene. This is an actual proper scene. And so it was, it just kind of, I thought, well, I wouldn't mind having a go at this. And it was literally just, it came out of that sort of quite innocent at the time, looking back on it now, sort of desire to kind of let off a bit of steam.
Yeah, and when you look even now, you know, I mean, it's been a good more than 10 years or so since you first started. Now I think it's really blossomed into even more, right? You, I mean, you have a dedicated magazine and websites and, you know, record labels and all sorts of things going on. It's pretty wild.
And award ceremonies. I mean, that's something that's gone mainstream when they start giving each other awards.
That's right. That's fantastic, though. It's fun. So, I mean, it's been about 8 years since the last album, and I guess, since the last studio album, and a few years since the Rockfield Files. Would you get the itch again, or what got you excited about doing another album?
It was just kind of, it's sort of, I was really busy. I mean, I was in the intervening time between the second album and this album, I was busy. I was raising a family. I've got four kids, and just trying to get some businesses off the ground to build my pension up. Basically, I was just, and it was one of those things where there's only so much time that I could, you know, in the day. I ran out of time basically, so that's why there was such a big gap. And I think over the course of that time, I had been writing little bits and pieces, but being so busy with everything else, I wasn't really kind of that focused on it. And then it was just a weird sort of kind of hallelujah moment where suddenly just all this stuff started to appear, you know, all this material and thoughts and a concept and chords and songs. And I sort of gathered little bits of music on dictaphones on my iPhone. You know, I've got little... I walk past the piano and be like, blong, blong, and blah, and it sort of... I have to sort of listen back 6 months later and go, what the hell was I thinking? And basically kind of over the course of that time, I start to build little songs together, and then it just kind of reached a critical mass, and suddenly it's all this stuff happened. And so I just thought, okay, well, I think this is probably time. So what I did is unusually for me, I shut up. I didn't go on the internet going, guess what, everybody, it's going to be, you know. So I just said, well, let's see what happens. And initially it was going to be a thing called Clouder, which was a sort of less of a frosting and more of a meeting because it was more electronic. But then as I was sort of progressing through it, pardon the pun, I kind of thought, actually, this is just Frost, isn't it? This is a Frost album. And so as soon as I sort of had that idea that it could be a Frost album, the floodgates opened, and it was really quick. Actually, it was kind of, I don't actually remember writing great chunks of it, and I've since found I've got like footage of me with a camera just filming sort of moments where I'm putting stuff together, and I was just thinking, I have no memory of that at all. And so it was like the first album, it kind of wrote itself. So I've just been very lucky in that respect with this one.
Did John doing The Lonely Robot push you along also, or was that sort of a completely separate coincidence?
It was, yeah, I mean, kind of, John, because he's really prolific. I mean, he's such a profound writer. You know, he's very, very good at going, here's all my ideas, and then you know, albums and albums and albums come out of him. And I think I remember listening to that, and there's always been, and he'll be the first person to say this, there's always a little bit, there's a very healthy, and it is very healthy, it's a healthy sort of rivalry between us. We are very kind of, it's very friendly competition. And I remember Lenny Ribble came and I thought, right, I'm having that. And it was literally kind of, and it was that, well, you're absolutely right, it was a thing of thinking, I can do that. So it's like a very, very slow game of prog tennis.
That's perfect.
That's a great way. So I'm waiting for the return volley now with Lenny Ribble too.
Do you guys, I mean, how closely do you work together on a Frost thing, or is it really, you know, out of your mind most of the album came out?
It's, well, we kind of, I mean, this is the first time we've co-written. We co-wrote, I think it was two songs, maybe three. And it was because we always like the same music, and we always, you know, we're all the same artists we really like, and all the same melodies and the same chords, and we get on really well as people, you know, and it's kind of, he's like my little brother in a way. And so it's sort of, we were just saying, it's mad that we haven't, you know, we've known each other now for 11 years or something, you know, it's mad we've never written together. So we put some time aside and just sort of said, well, let's just see what we come up with. And the first thing we came up with was Heartstrings. And so we thought, we should probably do this again. So, and then the next thing we did was Signs, I think, and Lantern, which is a B-side. And the problem we've got is because we're both really, really busy, and he doesn't live anywhere near me, so it's actually getting us together is very difficult. But when we do get together, it's kind of it's a really good kind of experienced writing. And also, I kind of wanted there's a track called Signs which John sings, and I really wanted that kind of, I like that difference on the album, because I remember on his Kino album Picture, there was a track called Swimming in Women which John Beck sang. I remember thinking, that's such a lovely idea that you've got a different voice in the middle of all that, you know. So Signs was very much his kind of vehicle, and I think the majority of the reason why I wrote the bulk of it was mainly just because of time constraints and sort of geography and the fact that I'm a gigantic control freak.
You know, Heartstrings, speaking of that song, that's one of the great songs on the album, as it's really sort of the production, it's massive when the drums come in and the whole thing, it's really great. But what made you bring that one back? Because you have a previous version of it on the Rockfield Files, right? And you put the sort of the video out recently, yeah. Just kind of reminding people about the song. I mean, I'm glad you did it again and did this version on here, but what made you do it?
I think I've got about, from this sort of writing session, I've ended up with about 25 songs, I think. And it was one of those things where it was really, really, when we sort of put it out, everybody, all the glorious Frost fans, they really, really liked it. And it was very much like, we love that song, we love that song. And it was really good live as well. It was really sort of, it went down really well live. And so it just kind of seemed mad not to sort of have a definitive version, really. I think it's kind of, it's you know, it needed to be recorded and kind of filed, I think. It was one of those songs that we thought, well, it needs to be on the album. And also, it segues really nicely into the next song as well. And also the lyric of it is really relevant to the whole concept of the album. So it was a bit of a no-brainer to put it on, really.
Speaking of the song that comes after it, has Cetriani on there. And I think most people, without knowing that, will hear it and immediately recognize him on there because he's so specific the way he sounds. So what brought him about on the album?
Well, I toured with them. I toured with him and Steve Vai.
Oh, that's right. I forgot. Yeah, you forgot about that.
We kind of, it was just one of those very natural, you know, he's a lovely guy, we get on really well. And you know, I didn't dare ask, but he'd kind of, when we were on tour, he'd look at, we did these films a while back called The Frost Reports, where we're just basically mucking around and having a bit of a laugh, and it was all quite surreal and strange. And I remember one day I came out from the bunks on the bus and we were driving somewhere, and I saw Joe was sitting in the lounge, and he was looking really sort of perplexed. I said, are you all right? Are you okay? And he said, what are these films? And he'd found all these thruster reports, and he was I think he was he did like them, but he was just kind of like, he was a bit perplexed by the stuff we were doing. And so he got to like Frost quite a lot, because I think it's quite surreal and subversive as a kind of entity. And so after the tour finished and stuff, I sort of said, you know, I don't want to impose, obviously, because, you know, it must be so tacky and people must ask you to do this all the time, but would you mind if you've just got 16 bars you could give me?
Right.
I think had it been like a sort of a full-on rock track, I think he probably would have said no, but because it's quite electronic, I think he was quite taken with that, because it's not something that he normally gets a chance to play over. And so I think he sort of came back to me, and he sent the files over and sent me an email going, I could have played over this for hours, because it's, you know, he kind of really enjoyed playing with the chord sequence, I think. And so it really works, because you've got that quite electronic sort of soundscape going on, and in the middle of it you've got Joe Satriani going wah.
No, that part's awesome. I think people will flip for that. That's fantastic.
Yeah, and he did, as I say, it's a brilliant solo as well, you know, and it's that tone, it's that classic Joe tone.
Yeah, you know, speaking of Million Town, that seems to be one album that when people talk about the prog favorites over recent years, one that pops up a lot, especially the title track, which is still to this day fantastic. Is that one that a lot of the fans still come to you about, and you know, you have to play it live when you tour, and it's like a big album that they hold dear?
Yeah, we have had. I mean, it's been one of those songs that kind of, but I mean, maybe because we haven't had that much material, it's always been a case of how we're going to fill an hour and a half at Million Town. That's a very, very nice job of taking up about 25 minutes. But now we've got new material, we've got an extra hour to play with. It's nice to rest it a bit, because it is, once you know, when you start a bar one, beat one, you're thinking, oh, there's a long way to go. And so it's nice to sort of to put it to bed for a bit and give it a rest. But yeah, I mean, people do they do kind of, that is a sort of benchmark for us, I think. That and The Dividing Line, which wasn't on an album, but that's kind of it's one of those tracks that people sort of like to hear, but it's nice to not have to do it this time. We're not doing it this time, I'll tell you that now. So
okay, well, that'll be interesting for people, but look, they'll be thrilled with the new album, so I think yeah, not a problem.
I think bands, they're always more interested in the new stuff, aren't they, at the moment? And then bear in mind that whole Sunlight Suite, those six songs, that's a kind of 32-minute epic in itself, so that gives us something to do.
You know, for the people that, you know, since it's been a while since an album was out, and maybe they're new to the band with this album, you know, explain the origin of the band name and the asterisk being in there as, you know, prominent.
Well, it's Frost. I don't know. It was again. It's one of these things that, you know, because I was working completely in a vacuum on my own. I hadn't played it to anybody. I hadn't contacted anybody. I think I had a blog, a little tiny blog, which no one was reading, and it was kind of, I was just doing this thing privately, just because it was a really good release valve for the pop stuff I was doing at the time. And I think the asterisk. Frost, the name, I think I was watching them, because obviously the weather in the UK is horrendous all the time. And I think it was this one winter, and there was a weather forecast on, and it was like a big sign over the map of the UK. There was a big sign saying Frost. I thought, I quite like that. And the asterisk, do you know what? There wasn't an asterisk. I don't quite know where it came from. I think it might have been Paul, our graphic designer. That might be his invention. I can't quite remember. But it arrived, and I thought, well, fair enough. And people say, what does it mean? What's the asterisk mean? And it kind of, it's, you know, because normally you have like a little sort of caveat, don't you? A little sentence at the bottom saying, you know, your mortgage can go down as well as up.
Right.
So I think it's like a health warning.
There you go. Well, at this point now, that's it. I mean, anybody has to print the name with it, or else they get in trouble, right? That's like a thing.
Well, tell me about it. I mean, we've got this terrible trouble, because the asterisk isn't on the logo on the front of the album. Immediately I got about 100 emails saying, what are you doing? So yeah, it is still part of the band, but I just thought it just didn't look right on the front of the album, so we took it off.
Well, there was a band, I don't know if you're familiar with a band called Panic at the Disco, sort of this pop band where they have, after Panic, they had an exclamation point, and after a few albums, they dropped the exclamation point.
That's right.
And everybody went crazy, and they had to put it back.
I'm hoping that the music is slightly more important than the asterisk.
Yeah. You know, I'm fascinated by your other career, and I know that in emails and stuff, we had mentioned that you work with Gary Barlow and some of that stuff. And I'm a big fan of some of the other kind of UK pop things, even that's not prog related. So,
yeah.
You know, I'm curious about some of that stuff that you still do, and what might be some of your favorite things that you've worked on, sort of outside of prog.
Yeah, I mean, it's about not doing one thing too much. You know, if I just did Frost, I'd probably go mad. You know, if I just did pop, I'd probably go mad. But having to do these different, or having the opportunity, be lucky enough to do these different things, is a really nice way of kind of balancing out the stresses of each individual kind of project. And I think probably at the moment, because it's one of the most recent things, it's this Fly album we've done, which is a sort of soundtrack album. There's a film out here at the moment, I don't know if it's been released in the States, called Eddie the Eagle. It was a sort of Britain's worst skier.
Right.
It's classic sort of British mentality. You know, we've made a film celebrating this bloke is rubbish. And so it's kind of like it's this sort of story of how he got to the Olympics and came last, obviously, but it was just that kind of Britain has this very endearing thing of, well, at least you tried, you know, there's that sort of mentality. So there was an accompanying album that I was asked to work on, which was very 80s inspired. So you got artists like Nick Kershaw and ABC and, you know, and Holly Johnson from Frankie Goes to Hollywood and all these kind of these very iconic 80s artists. And because I'm a child of the 80s, you know, Gary said to me, do you want to work on this? And I was like, oh, this'd be amazing. So I literally got the chance to sort of, you know, get the Jupiter 8 out and all the old emulator samples and Malin drum and, you know, all these sounds that were totally sort of iconic parts of my childhood growing up and watching people on TV programs with DX7s on A-frames and, you know, lots of dry ice and massive hair. It was a big part of my childhood. So I think at the moment it's been so much fun to do because it was all those things. I said, are we allowed to use all these things? He said, yeah, absolutely. You can bring it all back. You know, there's no rules. Just make it sound authentically 80s. And that was brilliant because it was really nice to kind of go back over those sounds and actually learn. Now I'm in a position to have my own studio, learn how it was all done, you know, back in the day. And
it was absolutely,
I mean, there wasn't a moment I wasn't just sat in the studio going, ha, this is brilliant.
Well, I'm with you though. I mean, I was a big fan of, and still am, of Nick Kershaw, all his current music, and the Sky's the Limit song is amazing. And
it's a great song.
You
amazing.
Know, Paul That's Young cool. and Howard Jones. I loved all that stuff growing up.
Yeah, and I think these artists have still got something to say. You know, they didn't embarrass themselves with the songs that they submitted to it. I mean, I didn't work on all of it, but I got to hear the album as a fan. You know, as much as anything else. And there wasn't a track where you sort of think, well, you know, probably, I don't know. It was just that lovely kind of. They're all still very vital artists with something to say. You know, their voices are all there, and you know, it's really really heartening to see that. Because I mean, Nick's such a great songwriter anyway.
Yeah,
there's a very sort of there's two weird things actually, because Go West are on the album as well, so there's this weird sort of Lonely Robot thing link, because Nick Kershaw played a guitar solo on Lonely Robot and Peter Cox from Go West sang on Lonely Robot, so there's a kind of weird even while I'm not doing prog, John Mitchell's there, his little face. It's kind of a weird tie-up.
Well, I'll tell you, one of the funny, when I first started doing this website and blog and starting to interview people, Nick Kershaw did a thing with Steve Hackett on the Genesis Revisited thing, and I was like, well, there's a way I can interview Nick Kershaw. And so I found a loophole in Prague to interview Nick Kershaw, and it was one of the...
He's a big prog fan. He's a big prog fan, yeah, isn't Nick?
That was one of my highlight interviews. So, you know, being that, again, that you're in the prog world and in the pop world, and you get to mesh the two, with the streaming and downloading, you know, what do you think about all that? And has it affected the pop stuff so much that, you know, maybe doing prog now is just as good? You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah, no, I think you're right. I think that's absolutely right. I think these days, everyone makes money from touring, I think, to be honest. I think the albums, it's almost gone back to that kind of 50s, 60s thing where the album was the sort of poster for your concerts, you know, people that would then go and see you. I think it's come right back round to that now, I think. And it's probably quite healthy for music in a whole to have it. I mean, this is, I'm probably going to get beaten to death by my fellow musicians. it's kind of, I think it probably needed taking a peg or down a peg or two, because it was just getting so preposterous, you know. I mean, I remember we did a track for Holly Valance back in the day, and I think we got paid about £10,000 to make the record, and then they spent £1 million in the video. And it was just that thing of thinking, well, hang on a minute, can we not have some of that? So it was this sort of, I think, you know, there's, in a way, I think it's been quite healthy that it's kind of forced people to really be better, you know. And I don't think, you know, if anybody going into music now, I don't necessarily think, you know, you're not going to end up with a apartment in, you know, Beverly Hills and five Humvees and stuff. I think it's more going back to being a bit more of honest kind of hard work, and it's probably, people are still making a living out of it, you know. There's a lot of prog bands have kind of actively sort of positively flourished, I think, since this has happened, because there's actually, you know, you can get your music out there a lot easier, and I think that's probably a good thing. If you're good, you shouldn't have anything to worry about.
Yeah, I mean, what I sort of have noticed, what I think has happened, is because, let's say you're a band starting out, maybe like a Frost, if a Frost is new, you know, you know, you can sort of assume, well, we're not going to get this on the radio, so we may as well just throw everything we want and just write whatever we want and do it to our core fans. And in a way, then it's more, like you're saying, more honest, and the core people that were going to like it.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, the difficult bit is just getting new music heard in the first place, because obviously it's just a huge sea of music now. It's as long as you can raise your hand up enough to get seen. I don't know how you do that, whether it's by a startling video or just a very, very good song. I think it makes bands work a bit cleverer and think a bit harder. And I think that's, you know, again, I think that's only good for creativity generally.
Yeah, sure. Well, listen, man, this is fun. Thanks for the interview. Great album. I think everybody's going to love it. And, you know, let's stay in touch and wish you the best.
Definitely. All right. I'll speak to you soon.
All right, man. Thank you. Bye.
Yes, bye.
Thanks to Jem for the interview. We're going to close with the first single off the album. This is Heartstrings. For more information and upcoming interviews, please check theprogreport.com, follow us on Facebook, at theprogreport on Twitter, or download the podcast on iTunes. Thanks.
so lightly.
If you drink the coffee.